and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, there's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the
will you please join us for A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Stand and let's praise the Lord together.
A mighty fortress is our God, a sword and shield victorious. He breaks a cruel oppressor's rod and wins salvation glorious. The old satanic foe has sworn to work us woe with craft and dreadful might. He arms himself to fight. On earth he has no equal. The hordes of devils fill the land, all threatening to devour us. stand. They cannot overpower us. Let this world tyrant rage, in battle we'll engage. His might is doomed to fail. God's judgment must prevail. The kingdom will you subdue him. God's word forever shall abide. No thanks to foes who fear it. For God himself fights by our side. The weapons of the Spirit, were they to take our house, goods, honor, child or spouse, though life be wrenched away, they cannot win the day. Kingdoms ours forever.
Amen. Please be seated. Yeah, happy Reformation Sunday. That's what this is. And welcome to the Lord's house today. Great to have you here in the Lord's house. And today we've got, because it's a special day, a Reformation Sunday, we've got a special guest with us. So Perry Frueling is here with us today. Perry is a pastor and from our denomination, LCMC, I'm going to blow the title that you've got. It's like, you know, okay, I don't want to put on a business card, but okay, yeah, he's in charge of stuff, okay? And he'll tell you more about that later. But Perry is somebody that Linda and I got to know. Perry and his family on the Israel trip that we took a year ago. And Perry was one of the leaders. It was a trip through our denomination, the LCMC. He and Mark Vandertig were leaders of the trip. So I got to know him and his family on that trip. Great, great people. And we get to have him here today to share the message with us. So look forward to what God has to say through him today. We've also got several great things coming up. We've got the Trunk or Treat coming up. If haven't signed up yet, but you could donate your trunk or your hatchback or your truck bed or whatever it might be for this event, that would be great. We've got a number of people who have, but we could use some more. And just talk to Adam, talk to me, and we'll get you part of that program. Also, we've got a deadline coming up here for families, for grandparents. It's important to let Adam know really immediately if your kid is going to be, or kids, plural, are going to be able to be participating in the Sunday school Christmas program, because he needs to plan for it. We were in weird times, you know, where you actually got to plan things. So please do let him know today if your kid or kids can be part of that program, okay? So important announcement there. He wanted me to get down on my knees and beg, but, you know, just picture that, okay? And by the way, I didn't even do this. Those of you at home, welcome. I didn't even say hi. All right, welcome. Glad that you're here with us, wherever you might be, and hope that you do find God's Spirit there as well as here, wherever it is that you might be worshiping. Then today, we've got a mass-only section, is this section right up here. So if you wanted to sit around people who were wearing masks, and that's all that were around you, that's the place to be, right up there. And you might have noticed a few different things with our construction project. Things are looking good, aren't they? Yeah, they're looking good. It's coming along. We've got a few more things to do. You feel free to wander around. We've got a youth room over here, new youth room. We've got The new nursery is open for the first time today, so you can stop back there, take a look at that area. We've got more things coming for the children's area back here, but it's coming along back there too. So, you know, feel free to wander around, take a look around as this project gets done around us. Women, I apologize. I'll celebrate with you in the future, but right now I'll apologize because the women's room here is shut down for construction, and it's going to be that way for a while, okay? Which means that you're asked if you need to use the restroom, just wander down this way and use the restroom down here as we work on that restroom there. By the way, thank you to those people who have been working on the project because it really makes a big, absolutely, hey, round of applause, absolutely. Makes a big difference in reducing cost and getting this thing done. And that takes a great sacrifice and investment to do that. So thank you for that. So anyway, with that, you know, next week is going to be the time change. Just to let you know, next week is the time change. It's the fun one, okay? Not the painful one, the fun one where we gain an hour. So in honor of that, let's take a look at this video right here.
We've all had those days. The days when you say to yourself,
please let me turn back time so I have no regrets. Let me change the past and avoid all the hurt.
The days you just want to flush down the drain.
I don't know why he cleans plates that day.
Hey, Mr. Meat Sweats. You ever wish you could turn back time? Well, you can't. Unless it's fallback.
Hey, me. I gotta go back.
Yes, fallback is the one time of year when you get to turn back time. An extra hour to consider a different choice.
It's time to turn.
An extra hour to turn back some regrets, some missteps, even some misspellings. And as a bonus, you'll all make it to church on time. So make sure to fall back, lose the regrets, and get to church on time.
All right, so there you have it, next week, yes. Hey, let's turn to the Lord in prayer. You know, it used to be where we would gather around people, somebody that might have a prayer need or something, and be seated and we gather around them. You know what, I think every one of us here has a prayer need, so we're all going to remain seated, okay? And let me pray over you now, okay? Lord God, we lift up to you the needs that are before you. Lord, whatever those might be, Lord, we are living in challenging times, times of division, Lord, times of stress, Lord, times of just being overwhelmed with things going on in life. But Lord, you are the one, you are our anchor, you are our rock, and we turn to you now, Lord God, as the one who lifts us up. And Lord, we pray for that. On this Reformation Sunday, Lord, when we remember those people who have gone before us, people of the faith who stood during challenging times in their day, Lord God, we stand for you now during these times. Lord God, whatever that is that we might be facing right now, Lord God, we pray that you'd meet us at that place, Lord, whatever that might be. Those who are facing financial difficulties, Lord, we pray for your provision. Lord, those who need your healing power, Lord God, we pray that you'd pour that out, Lord God, that you'd meet us right now, Lord, in this place. Lord, relational challenges, Lord God, we pray that you'd mend families. Lord, those who are facing times of loneliness, Lord God, isolation, Lord, we pray that you'd be with them, Lord. And Lord, we lift up to you these people, Lord, by name, because we know what their needs are, Lord God. They need your healing power. We pray for Charlotte Van Halle, for Judy Noel, Rose Cotner, Virginia Shabatis, and the daughter of Wade and Heather Quillen, Lord God. We pray for each one of these people. Pour out your power and your might. Lord God, we also pray that you'd be with the family of Howard Beslack, who passed away. Lord God, that you'd be with them and give them your strength and your peace. Lord, all of this we lift up to you now. As all God's people said, amen. Let's worship our Lord together. Please stand.
God is awesome. He can move mountains, keep me in the valley, hide me from the rain. My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken, strength where I've been weakened. Forever He will reign. My God is awesome. Oh, He is awesome. God is awesome. Lord, He is awesome. My God is awesome. Oh, He is awesome. Is awesome Savior of the whole world, giver of salvation. By His stripes I am healed. My God is awesome. Today I am forgiven. His grace is why I'm living. Praise His holy name. My God is awesome. God is awesome. He can move mountains, keep me in the valley, hide me from the rain.
Hide me from the rain.
My God is awesome. Strength where I've been weakened, and where I've been weakened. Praise His holy name.
Thank you. Our first reading comes from Romans chapter 1, verses 16 through 17. I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith, first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. Here ends our first reading. Our gospel today is from the book of John, chapter 8, verses 31 through 36. Please rise as you're able. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed." Here ends the reading of our gospel. Let us now profess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
And thank you very much, Gary. At this time, I'd like to invite the kids to come forward for the children's message. So feel free to come on up at this time, and we're going to have a very special guest that will be sharing God's word with you today.
All right, you guys, it's really not going to be me who's going to be sharing the message. We have a great video that we're going to watch. Today is called Reformation, and Reformation is a big day in the Lutheran Church. It's a big day in most churches, I think, because it's the day we remember that everything came back to Jesus, and it was all about Jesus. So we're going to watch this video about Reformation and learn about Martin Luther, who is a guy who started the Reformation like 500 years ago. So let's take a look at the video. Turn and watch up there, okay?
Okay. I'm really tired. I wanna translate the Bible for a little bit, and then I wanna go to bed. Na na na, never failing.
Martin Luther.
This is the story of Martin Luther.
Martin Luther was a really smart boy.
You need to go be a lawyer.
He went to school, but he didn't like it. So he went to his dad and said, I don't want to be a lawyer anymore.
His dad said, get out of here. Get out of here. I don't want to see you anymore.
Martin Luther was sad,
and he went into the forest.
There was a big storm.
And there was a big, mean storm up above. And then Martin Luther was so scared. And then Martin Luther prayed for God. And they said, my God, please save me. Please save me.
I'll be a monkey if you save me, God.
Not a monkey.
A monk.
It's not a monkey, it's a monk.
Oh, okay, that makes sense.
And then God said, okay.
Good. So God saved Martin Luther.
So Martin Luther went to school to learn about the Bible.
He learned a lot about the Bible. But the church was doing bad stuff.
But he saw the church was being bad. That's so. He's a bad guy. The people was giving him money. Then he said, God, if you give me money, God will forgive you.
Give me more money. And then Martin Luther said, that's not right. That's not in the Bible.
And then he wrote the 95 theses and then stamped them in the door.
And then Johann Gutenberg found the 9 theses and he made lots of copies of the 95 theses.
Oh, I can make copies of this. This is good.
And then everybody was reading.
And the Pope and the King were not like that.
So the Pope and the King got really mad. The Pope and the King, they're really mad. And then they called him to the worms.
And that's when they called him to the
diet worms.
Not like fishing worms.
Lord's been good to me, and so I say the Lord, forgiving me the things I need, like the salt and the fruit and the apple seed. The Lord is good to me. Amen, 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 amen. Eat up, eat up, eat up, eat up, eat up.
Worm is a place in Germany.
So they put Martin Luther in trial. He told him, stop saying those things.
Martin Luther, stop staring those things. That's not right. You are heretic.
Then the Pope said, you're a heretic.
I stand here. I stand here. I do no other. And the Pope and the King got even more mad.
So he burned his disorder in front of the church, and then he really got in trouble. So he hid in a castle for a long time. And then his hair grew like Rapunzel, and then his beard grew. When he was hiding, he seen people being bad. So he went out hiding. And then he told the people, stop being good to each other. So he wanted people to read the Bible. So he translated it to German.
And some nuns were in trouble. And then they text Martin Luther. Please save us, Martin Luther. Please help me, Martin Luther.
So he finally helped them.
And he saved the nuns, and then one nun didn't have anything to do.
Hi, I'm Cat Alina.
So Martin Luther said, well, okay, do you want to marry me?
Sure, okay.
So and then they made a big family.
People started getting sick, and then they died. So Martin Luther wrote a song to help them feel better.
A mighty fortress is our guide. Da 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 da, never failing.
A mighty fortress is our guide. Da da da, never failing.
That's how the Reformation started, and the church got back on track.
Yay, Martin Luther!
And then Martin Luther died.
Wow, what a story, huh? That's the Reformation story told by kids. And you know, what it tells us really is that it's all about coming back to the Bible, about doing things God's way and telling us about Jesus. Can you pray with me? Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for your love for each of us. And pray, dear God, that on this Reformation Sunday, that you'll remind every child here that they are so loved, and you love them so much, Jesus, because of what you did on the cross for us. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Everybody said amen? Amen. All right, I think you guys are going that way with Adam over there. Don't be scared. Just go with Adam. It'll be okay, all right? Going that way. There you go. And you guys have a song, is that right? All right, there we go.
All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your goodness. All over my life, all over my life, I see the promises in fulfillment. All over my life, all over my life. Help me remember when I'm weak, feel
hands of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. Why should
I love it. And what a great band. You guys are so blessed here with music. I've had a chance to be at all three services, and they say the best for last, I think. This is awesome. So great to have you guys here. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. I'm Perry. My last name is Fruling. I like to tell people it's sounds like fooling, only with an R. So I'm just fruling around, or I'm not fruling anybody sometimes. But and that's supposed to be funny, and I know you people at home are watching and are just laughing out loud. Here it's kind of crickets, okay? But I do, the coordinator for pastoral ministry is the title, and like, you know, it should be like chief cook and bottle washer or something, I suppose, but it's coordinator for pastoral ministry, and I do three C's, and I come home, when my wife comes home for work, because I work out of my home, she says, what'd you do today? And I said, it's always the three C's. The C is, one of them is certifications. Pastors coming into our organization, I work with them to get certified. The second is call processes. So I work with churches around the country, helping them to have good processes when they try to call a pastor. And the third one, the third C, is conflict. And so I'm getting typically a few calls a week at churches struggling with something and in conflict. But it's good that we're working on it, because we want to resolve conflicts God's way. And so it's never anything to be afraid of. Sometimes I tell people I'm a little bit like a firefighter. I'm running into the building and other people are running out. But that's okay, because I've got some, you know, water hoses and some tools to fight fires with. So I love that ministry, and it's been very good. I've been doing that for 3 years. Before that, as a pastor down in Texas for 6 years, I also was in Northern Iowa as a solo pastor for a few years, and then have been a senior pastor for about 20 years in my ministry. So it's good to be with you on Reformation Sunday. This mic is a little hot to me, by the way. I don't know if you could just back it off a slight bit. There we go. Or it might be something coming from over here. So I've worked, you know, with mics too over the years. But it's good to be with you on Reformation. You guys are in this sermon series called Church Matters. And what I love about that is really the question, is church still relevant in this 21st century? We like to call LCMC a first century church for the 21st century. What is it about that early church that can translate into who we are today? And I would like to say the title of today's message really is relevant. And it says, because it has a history. The church has a history. It has a past. And today what I want to bring to you is some Old Testament and some New Testament stories, and then all the way up to the Reformation. And I know you're going, oh, this is going to be a sleeper, but I think it'll hopefully excite you a little bit about the relevance and why the church matters today. So let me start off. I like always a little humor, and we never know how this is going to go one day, but here's this story anyway. Is St. Peter is at the gates of heaven, and a woman arrives there, and she says, hey, St. Peter, I'd like to get into heaven. And St. Peter says, that's easy. All you have to do is spell one word. And she says, what's that? And he says, love. And she says, okay, L-O-V-E, love. He says, that's right. Come on in. And he says, now hang on just a second. The Lord has called me off on an errand. So if you can stand here and do for anyone else who comes up to the gates of heaven what I just did for you, then that'll be great. Well, I go run this errand. She says, okay. So St. Peter goes off. She stands at the gate, and as fate would have it, her husband of many years shows up at the gates of heaven just at that time. And he hadn't been all that great of a fellow during his life on earth, so he was really relieved to see her at the gates of heaven. He says, I'd like to get into heaven. She says, oh, that's easy. All you have to do is spell one word. He says, what's that? And she says, Czechoslovakia. For those of you who are younger, that used to be a country back in the old days. All right, so aren't we glad that as we gather as the people of God, it's truly about love and not about somehow our ability to spell or our ability to live a good life, to live the way the law, the Old Testament would tell us to live, but instead that we have a God who says, I love you, and by his grace that when we appear at the gates of heaven one day, the answer is love. It's about the love of Jesus Christ that he has given us. And that's what Reformation does, is it brings us back to the very basic message of Scripture, which has just, you know, gotten sidetracked and polluted along the way. And Luther brought us back to that. We'll talk a little bit about that on the way. So when I work with conflict around the country, I've trained some coaches now who can go in and do what I do to help congregations in conflict. And so one of those I was talking with this week, and he actually is deaf. And, you know, I had my questions, okay, how will that work, you know, but he's so insightful and has so many great things to say. And he was talking to me about the passage of Scripture that follows the one that we're going to be talking about today in chapter 9, where Jesus heals a man who's blind. He also heals a man who is deaf on another occasion. I'm just realizing that's a different chapter. And he says to the man who's deaf, he says to him, Ephphatha, which is an Aramaic word, which means be opened. And he was telling me, this guy who's deaf, he was telling me that it's only Christ who can open our hearts and our minds and our ears to hear and see when he says to us, Ephphatha. So I thought today, as a part of the message, I would kind of use that analogy to help you to catch some things that are important for this passage of Scripture and for Reformation Sunday. And so the first thing I want to share with you today is and that God would do this, but to open your mind to God's power. I'm sorry, open your mind to God's promise. Did it come up right? Open your mind to God's promise. And here's where I want to start with that, is to go back to John chapter 8, this passage of Scripture that was read just a few moments ago. And Jesus is there, and there are some guys from the religious leaders from around the day, and they're, you know, they're the kind of people who are trying to draw circles of who's in and who's out, who's righteous and who's not. And they don't know quite what to do with Jesus, because he's hanging around with, you know, the kind of wrong kind of people, and yet he's a miracle worker and a healer and a great teacher. And they're not sure what to do. He shows up for this great festival in Jerusalem, and they kind of ask him some questions. And Jesus says this. He says, if you abide in my word, you're truly my disciples, and you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So what does it mean to be in Jesus' word? What is Jesus' teaching? What's his word? What is the truth that will set us free? So Jesus has been dealing with the religious leaders who have interpreted the Old Testament in such a way that it comes to their advantage. There's another book of the Bible that I love. It's called Galatians. It's my favorite book of the Bible. In book of Galatians, Paul explains that these people who have turned to the law for their hope, he says, what are you doing? He says, Jesus saved you by his grace on the cross. Now you want to go back to trying to keep the law and to circumcision? He says, no, the law was never intended for that. You're getting it all wrong. In fact, Galatians chapter 3 says these words. It says, now before faith came, we were imprisoned, and we were guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. So faith came along through Christ. The law was there to help us until Christ arrived to know God's will. So let's go back a little bit further. In the book of Genesis, chapter 12, God makes a promise to a person named Abraham. I'm sure we've all heard of Abraham. In Genesis chapter 12, God says to him, Abraham, I will bless you, I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing to the nations. I dare you to read Genesis 12 through 25 and see if anywhere in Genesis 12 through 25, God says, well, Abraham, you're a really good guy. And so because of that, I'm going to make you the father of many nations. Or, Abraham, if you do these things, then I will bless you. It doesn't say that. I dare you to read it. All it says is, Abraham, I chose you, I'm going to bless you. In fact, Abraham does a lot of things to try to mess that up. If you look at the stories in Genesis 12 through 25, Abraham's kind of doubting God. At some point, he laughs at him. He winds up having a child with another woman that it is not the heir. He's totally getting it wrong, but God still loves Abraham. Abraham didn't do anything. And so we read Scripture as it comes along next. Moses comes along about 400 years later. And he says, okay, he says, we're the children of the promise. Now, here's the family rules. Here's the kind of what we're going to do, how we're going to live, how we're going to show people the love of God. And that comes in Exodus chapter 20, and it says this, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, therefore. Whenever you see therefore in the Bible, somebody told me once, you got to ask, what is it there for? And also, you got to ask, you know, what are we there for? We are there for to keep God's commands to love one another. So Scripture goes on to say, you know, you should not steal, you should not bear false witness, you should not commit adultery. But the Old Testament is a reflection back on this is your response to God's grace in your life. So let me share that Galatians, in the book of Galatians, Paul tells the people of Galatia, that promise that was made to Abraham is not nullified by the covenant that God made with Moses, which means that it's not about how well you keep the law, it's still about God's promise to Abraham. Let me explain. There's a story that I love about a father who was trying to teach his kids about grace. This is a pastor who was down the road from me, and he wrote an article in the paper, and he shared the story. And he said, I was trying to teach the kids about grace, so we were in our home at night, and I said to them, if you can figure out how to get to the top of the stairs, he says, I'll go to the top of the stairs, you get to the bottom of the stairs, and if you can figure out how to get to the top of the stairs without touching the side rails or the side walls or the stairs, he says, I'll take you all out for ice cream tonight. It's a hot summer night in Iowa. And so they got down to the bottom of the stairs, and he stood at the top of the stairs. And they looked at him and with incredulous eyes, like, how can we ever do this? And he said, you just have to think. And they looked at him and said, Dad, there's no way. And he said, yes, there's a way. And all of a sudden, the light bulb came on in one of the little girl's mind. She says, I know, Dad. You come down the stairs and get us. And so Dad came down the stairs, and individually he put each one on his back and carried each one to the top of the stairs without touching the side rails, the side walls, or the stairs, and they all went out for a little ice cream that night. I love that story because it illustrates the difference between Christianity and all other world religions. Because in some faiths, you know, if we just live this according to these rules, these laws, maybe one day God will accept you. Or if you just live this kind of a life, maybe one day you'll come back as a cow or reach nirvana. Or if you live with this kind of passion for God, maybe you'll have seven virgins in heaven awaiting you. But not only that, in Christianity, we can kind of lose our way. We can start to think that, you know, that's right, Jesus, you know, carries us home, but that maybe I should climb off and start climbing a little bit myself. The good news is that Christ has come down to us and he has brought us home. You know, when man reaches for God, it's called religion. But when God reaches for humankind, it's called relationship. Jesus came to carry us home, not so that we might not have to climb stairs. That's God's promise that was revealed in Abraham long before Moses ever showed up. When Moses shows up, and when you read the Old Testament, you need to understand this. When Moses shows up, it's giving the family rules. It's saying, here's how we're going to live together. Here's how we're going to respond to God's grace. But by the time Jesus comes in John chapter 8, the religious leaders are saying it's the law by which we're saved. It's the law that determines who's in and who's out. And here's what I'm here to tell you today, is that you have to open your mind to God's promise. The promise that was revealed back to Abraham at the beginning, which was fulfilled in Jesus Christ when it says, I will make you a blessing to the nations, that Christ would bless the entire world through this line of Abraham. Open your mind to God's promise. Secondly, open your heart to God's and to Christ's power. So this whole thing of Abraham's promise, what does it mean? And they were confused about who Abraham is. And they said this. They said, we're offspring of Abraham. We've never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say we'll become free? And Jesus would go on to say, truly I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. They were thinking it was their ancestral connection to Abraham that saved them. It was their bloodline. But Jesus says, no, it's a matter of faith. Think about the passage of Scripture in Genesis 15, 6, where God says, it says, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now, there's that word righteousness. Isn't that an interesting word? If you looked in the Old Testament and you look at it, you can get some misunderstanding believing that you somehow are righteous when you live a righteous life. Luther would say, we look back on the Old Testament, we always read it with Christ's eyes, that we are made righteous through Christ. And see, this the religious leaders who were standing around Jesus were trying to conclude that they could become righteous on their own and that they were free because they were connected to Abraham ancestrally, so they didn't have to worry. But Jesus says, no, it's a matter of sin. And the book of Matthew chapter 5, it's called the Sermon on the Mount, the greatest sermon ever preached, where Jesus goes through the law and he ties down the law in such a way that you'll never be able to keep it. He says, you've heard it said, you shall not commit adultery, but I say, if you've ever lusted after a woman in your heart, you've committed adultery. You've heard it said, you shall not murder, but I say to you, if you've ever been angry with someone, you've already broken that commandment. And so on. You should not steal. You know. So Jesus ties down the law so that the Pharisees who were trying to be self-righteous, to keep the law in such a way that they could conclude that they had earned their way, and Jesus says, no, I'm sorry. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. The power is not in you and me, dear friends in Christ. The power is in the cross of Christ. So when Luther comes along in the 1500s, he rediscovers it on a verse in Romans that was read just a few moments ago. It says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. To the Jew first and to also the Greek, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith, for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Luther read this and he realized that righteousness was not from himself, but righteousness came from God. He called it an alien righteousness, a righteousness that's not my own. You see, he'd been trying to live the perfect life. He had been trying to please God with the life that he was living. He would, you know, whip himself and he would try, you know, to work long hours and pray endlessly to try to please God. He was trying to be righteous. But when he discovered Romans 1, 16 and 17, he says, what? Righteousness doesn't come from me? It can only come apart from me. There's a guy in the fifth century AD. His name was Pelagian. Pelagian said that my will is good enough to be able to find the things of God and do the will of God and to please God, and so that I can merit my salvation. Thanks be to God, the church rejected him, so Pelagius became a heretic. And, instead the church went more with somebody named Augustine and his understanding that our righteousness comes from God. But I had a seminary professor who, he said, when somebody would say something that would kind of get us back into, we have to do a little bit more, we have to, do something on our own, he would say, well, that sounds a little bit like hemi-semi-demi-neo-Pelagianism to me. And I'm here to tell you, dear friends, I am guilty of hemi-semi-demi-neo-Pelagianism. Because there's plenty of times in my life where I like to crawl off of Jesus' back and start climbing those stairs on my own again. And I become judgmental towards others because I'm looking around saying, I'm up here on this step and you're down there, right? I mean, you understand how that works? And it's in all of our lives. We begin doing that. We begin treasuring ourselves and what we can do and what we have to offer. We want to climb back onto the altar and sacrifice ourselves again. Oh, Lord, here I am. It's me again. I'm here. You see me, what I'm doing. Now, don't pay attention to that guy over there. He's not doing a very good job, Lord. Makes me feel better about myself until I really discover and remember who I really am. Paul says in the Bible, not one of us is righteous, no, not one. The true treasure is Christ. I love this story about a man and a woman, husband and wife. They were jewelers, and they had decided that when they found the perfect gem, that wherever they were, they would be in contact with each other. They would take a look at the gem, and if the price was right, they would purchase a perfect gem. So the wife was off to a gem show in London, and he was stateside. And this is back in the old days when they were sending telegrams, but for those of you who are texting these days, especially you young folks, this will be of interest to you. So she's over there, and she sends him a telegram, and she says, have found the gem, but the price is, and then she listed the price. And he sees the price, he sends back a telegram, he says, no, price too high. A week or so later, she comes home, she knocks on the door, he opens the door, and she greets him at the door with a smile on her face, and she says, I've got it, and it's amazing. And he says, didn't you get my telegram? And she said, yes, and here's the gem. And he looked at it, and he had to admit, it was everything that they had been looking for. It was a thing of beauty. It was perfect. And he said, but didn't you get my telegram? And she said, yes, I even saved it. Here it is. When he looked at the telegram, he realized something was missing. A comma. Instead of it saying no, price too high, it said no price too high. Now, you texting kids, just remember that when you're texting without all these, commas and things. My kids do that all the time. Listen, God looked at us, and he could have said, in your sin and your shame and your guilt, he could have looked at us and said, no, price too high. But instead, he looked at us through the love of Jesus Christ and the power of the cross to redeem and to save and to forgive and give new hope to us. And he said, there's no price too high for turning our sin-sick lives into the beauty of what Christ has to offer us and to create in us. We are beautifully created, but even more beautifully redeemed in Christ. Open your mind to God's promise, your heart to Christ's power, but thirdly, open your life to God's purpose. So Jesus, in the end of this passage of Scripture that is quite a famous passage of Scripture for Reformation Sunday, he says, the slave does not remain in the house forever, but the son remains in the house forever. So if the son sets you free, you'll be free indeed. So the slave is not an inheritor. The slave doesn't inherit the father's wealth, the father's estate. And if you think back to the story of the prodigal son, remember that story where the prodigal son asks for his inheritance? He runs off and he squanders it on wild and excessive living. But the other son stays home. And at the end of that story, there's an interesting thing that the older son says. You know, they're throwing a party for the younger son, and he's kind of upset about that. And he says to his dad, all these years I've been slaving for you, and never did you throw a party for me. And the son gives it away, doesn't he? He's been living at home. He's been slaving. He's been a slave to the law, while his other brother was a slave to the world. And he reveals that when he was in the Father's presence, that he was just trying to earn his way. I think Jesus is definitely telling that story to the Pharisees and the religious leaders of this day who you know, were purporting that we can determine who's in and who's out. The prodigal son, he's out. But the son who is at home, he is in. Because he's been at home, he's been keeping the rules, he's been doing the right things. Oh, Lord, do you see me? I'm trying a little harder, God. I'm getting closer to you. And Jesus says, no, he's just a slave. Because he hasn't really allowed the Father's love to be what defines him. And so Jesus says the slave doesn't remain in the house, but the son does. So if the son sets you free, you'll be free indeed. And there's really a picture in that story there, and in this story too, of two ditches that are on the side of the road of faith. One ditch has this legalism that I've been describing, this, you know, keep the law, try to do the right things. I know that Jesus has saved me, but I got to keep climbing those stairs. I got to be better. I got to do what's right. I got to keep up. And if I don't, you know, I'm not going to be there. So that's on one side, the legalism, where I'm judging other people and looking at them because, you know, and that's what happens with legalism. I'm useless in the kingdom because all I do is make other people feel bad. And then on the other side is this, you know, worldly, this kind of living, you know, as I want to live. And the word is antinomianism. And my wife says, quit using that word. People don't understand it. It's antinomian means no law. I'm against any law. And it means that I want to just live my life and do whatever I want to do, and I don't have to answer to anybody. And it's really a result of giving up. I give up. And here's the people that Jesus were hanging out with a lot of times, right? The prostitutes and the tax collectors and the sinners. He was accused of being a drunkard, by the way, because he was hanging out with this group of people. And Jesus was there, you know, trying to show them love and grace and mercy because they had been expelled by this group over here, the legalists. And so Paul in the book of Galatians says, so how are we to live? You know, he's already chided them for trying to go back to legalism. He says, but don't let your freedom become an opportunity for this wild living. He calls it licentiousness. But he says, we who are in Christ are in the Spirit. God, it says, has given you the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience. He says there's no law against the fruits of the Spirit. God's calling us to walk as by faith. Faith is a gift from God. It comes as a gift of the Holy Spirit. We live on this road not saying nothing matters and not at the same time saying, okay, I've got to do all these. No, Jesus, fill me with your Spirit. Luther would say, we stand before God as beggars, and it's at least rumored or reported that he died with a crumpled note in his hand that said, we are beggars before God. And that's how we have to live, knowing that I'm forgiven, that I'm free, keeps me from judging others who may not have that yet. It helps me to love those who are missing that in their life. And it's a message that needs to be heard so dearly in our world today. So there's a, I have a daughter who has had a lot of difficulty in life. She's got Asperger's, and it's on the autism spectrum. And so life has been challenging, right? I mean, it's hard with relationships. It's one of the difficulties for folks with Asperger's. And she's had a lot of challenges with decision-making and things like that. A few years ago, she let us know that she was pregnant and she wasn't married. And her boyfriend at that point was an abusive person. And so we invited her to come home. And so she lived with us for a couple of years. And this little child, I call her Baby Cakes. She's our little granddaughter. She just, you know, stole our hearts. And I still don't know where my heart is. It's stolen and I still don't have it back yet. But she's 4 years old now. And so after a couple of years, our daughter moved out, and not long after, another person moved in with her. And we, you know, struggled with that. We were in pretty deep pain, and honestly, we weren't in a good place, and we were frustrated. You know, I think that probably through our tone of voice or just the way that maybe we carried ourselves, you know, she probably felt that judgment, right? And then we decided, hey, we've just got to love. we've just got to love. They were expecting a child. And we began to, you know, just reach out to them in ways that were loving. And eventually, the father and this of now our grandchild and his son began to come to church with us. This little boy who had never heard about Jesus now is walking around talking about Jesus all the time. And the father started bringing the kids to church, even when my daughter has to work sometimes on Sunday mornings. He's got the kids there. He wants to have the kids baptized. And they said their wedding vows in August. God is at work, but God can only work through us when we are in the Spirit, not in a spirit of judgmentalism. And I think the spirit of licentiousness is another side of it too, where God isn't able to work through us. But when we're in the Spirit and say, God, fill me, forgive me, grace me so that I can forgive and grace others. When I'm on the stairs and when I'm climbing stairs, I'm looking around and judging others. That's no good. It doesn't work for us. It doesn't work for your witness in the kingdom. And you know, when we're riding Jesus's back, there's just two responses, right? Is to high five other people like, whoa, this is so awesome. God has forgiven me. I'm free. It is so awesome. Aren't you happy? Yeah, we're all high five. And that's worship. That's what's worship. And when we're singing today, God is awesome. I mean, that's what we're doing. And the other thing we're doing is telling other people, this is awesome. You're going to want to get on board. It's totally free. That's called evangelism. And we're just loving each other in the midst of that. God has deployed you. God has already put you in a place where he wants you. You know, we might have thought it was Africa or Haiti where our church does some missions, and I've been, but it turned out it was in our own home. It's in our neighborhood. It's in our relationships at work. It's where our kids play ball. You know, I was always frustrated on Sunday mornings that they were playing baseball. You know, my son got moved to the bottom of the batting order because he didn't show up on Sunday mornings. And then I thought, what am I doing? That's the mission field out there. Why aren't we having church out there? We're already deployed. God's got you right where you want you. I've got a guy at church, he took this stuff seriously, and he started at Great America Leasing in Cedar Rapids, 500 employees, and he's just started having, you know, relationships with people in a small group meeting. Now there's 45 or 50 people coming to pray in the mornings. Wherever you are, you're already deployed. Now, you might say, like Moses in the Bible, who, me? Or you might say, like Jonah, the prophet, not me. Or you might say, like Habakkuk, who is the Old Testament prophet, why me? Or maybe today, as you look at that the church matters because of this great promise to Abraham, fulfilled in Jesus Christ, you might say, like Isaiah the prophet, here I am, Lord, send me. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for your forgiveness, which on this Reformation Sunday, God, we return and remember the ultimate promises that were begun in Abraham, fulfilled in Jesus, which have to be refined over and over again as we get lost trying to climb stairs. God, help us simply to recognize your grace for us and then to forgive and love others. We praise you, Lord, for your promise, for your power, and for the purpose you've given us to live this life. Jesus, you are awesome. Let us simply respond with a heart filled with your Holy Spirit, singing your praise and love, reaching out to others. In Jesus' name, we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I invite you to please rise, and thank you very much, Perry, for sharing the word of the Lord with us all three services this weekend, and the Lord's continued blessings to you and service to the kingdom through the LCMC. Now, may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look upon us with his favor and grant us his perfect peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. For those worshiping with us in the sanctuary here today, a reminder following the closing song to please be seated. The ushers will dismiss by row on the first level, and those of you seated in the balcony, dismiss your mic going out, but we're going to worship the Lord.
Stop.